Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 18th meeting of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee in 2022. Before we begin, can I remind members using electronic devices to please switch them to silent. Our first item of business today is an evidence session on the Hunting with Dogs Scotland Bill with the Scottish Government Bill Team. And I welcome Hugh Dignan, the Head of Wildlife and Flood Management Unit, Leah Fitzgerald, the team leader from Wildlife, the Legislation Team, and solicitors Hazel Riley and Amy Hogarth. Good morning. And we're just going to kick off with questions. We've got around about 75 minutes. So I'd like to ask, we've had a huge response to the survey and the questionnaire that was put out, but it would appear that it's very mixed, with 50% of those responding for the bill and 50% not. So it looks like there's almost a perfect split between those who wish to continue with the legislation at the moment and those who wish to see changes. Does that mean you've got this bill wrong?
Well, I sincerely hope not. This has been an issue which has been sort of in the government's mind for a long time. You know, with the it goes back to when we asked Lord Bonamy to review the existing legislation back in 2015. And I think that was against the background of fairly widespread concern that although people in Scotland largely thought that fox hunting was banned, that there were still activities ongoing that looked very much like fox hunting, and alongside that there were very few prosecutions. So there were some big question marks around that. And I think at the time when we asked Lord Bonamy to do a review, and he carried out his review and then reported in 2016, and we consulted on those proposals at the time, there was a large majority then in favour of the sort of changes that were being proposed by Lord Bonamy. And I think, you know, in terms of how people are responding to this bill, we know it's a very polarising issue. We know there are people who feel very strongly against it. There are people who feel very strongly in favour of further restrictions. And I guess the response to any consultation is likely to pick up those sort of strong views on either side. Our suspicion is that the large majority of people in Scotland are concerned about the use of dogs to hunt mammals and want to see that tightly controlled, and the activity of chasing and killing mammals to be banned. And I think most people would think that that's what the law already does, but maybe it doesn't do it as effectively as it should. So I think that we've got the bill right, and I think that that's what our ministers think too.
Thank you. You mentioned the Lord Bonamy review. Why haven't you followed its outcomes, given it was an independent and fairly wide and robust review? Why have you strayed away from Lord Bonamy's recommendations?
Well, I think for the most part we've followed his recommendations, especially around the sort of key issues that we asked him to look at, which was around how effective is the bill in its use of language and its drawing up of the offences and its usableness by prosecutors and police officers and so on. So that, I mean, to that extent, we have largely followed it. There are, of course, though, as you'll be well aware, a number of areas where we didn't pursue it, around the introduction of vicarious liability and the reverse burden of proof. And we've also added some other elements in which have been things which we've developed independently of Lord Bonamy's thinking.
Thank you. I'll move to questions from Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. I appreciate that you're not here to speak for the political or wider ethical issues here. So, I mean, if I can concentrate on some of the stuff that's gone into the bill, I just wonder if you could explain a bit about the aims and the sense of what bits of 2002 specifically the government is seeking, what loopholes it is seeking to plug. I don't look for a comprehensive list, but we're at the point now, obviously, where this has to be explained and debated with the public. So can you set out what those aims are and what loopholes you're seeking to plug?
Well, as I mentioned, there are a number of issues around the language that was used in the 2002 Act. I'll ask my colleague Leah to talk about those in a minute. But there are also, as I say, some other issues where we thought that, I think, with the benefit of reflecting on that legislation, it was the first legislation of its type in the UK, and looking at how things developed in other parts of the UK and our own experience with operating it here in Scotland, we thought there were further things which we could build into that. So those are, as you know, the things like the two-dog limit and so on, and the licensing scheme that's associated with that. But if I may, I'll ask Leah to talk about the specific way that we changed the wording to deal with some of the offences. Is that okay, Leah?
As you know, we took the approach, instead of seeking to amend the original legislation, to bring forward a new act, and that just allowed us to, you know, tackle the language issues and just overall modernise it. But, you know, for example, Lord Bonamy raised issues with the word deliberately, and that was potentially sort of stopping successful prosecutions being brought because of the threshold and, you know, the sort of uncertainty as to what constituted deliberate. So that was one of the things that we looked at. We introduced the phrase using a dog to make it sort of clear that it's the person who is doing the hunting and not the dog. And so that will also make sure that it's clear that if somebody's just out walking their dog and the dog runs off, that they're not guilty of an offence that wouldn't constitute hunting. We also just updated some of the language to make those sorts of things clear. I think, as Lord Bonamy acknowledged in his report, in spite of the fact that under the 2002 Act, hunting with dogs was banned, that evidence suggested, I think, up to 30% of foxes were still being chased and killed by dogs. So that clearly shows that there were issues with the Act, and it was very clear from the responses to the original consultation that even amongst stakeholders there was a lot of uncertainty as to what certain provisions actually meant and what it allowed them to do. So we've kind of seeked to address it from the top down by hopefully having very clear provisions which set out what is and isn't permitted.
Can I ask also on that point, or related to those points, in seeking to address welfare concerns in this piece of legislation, is a distinction being drawn between mounted and other types of hunts at any point, given these are different activities, or are they both being treated the same?
No, it's quite clear from all of the work we've done in developing it that the Act is about the use of dogs for hunting any wild mammals. I think a lot of people kind of look at the original Act just through the lens of fox hunting, but that is only one kind of type of wildlife management that's undertaken with dogs. So we needed to make sure that in developing the Act, it addressed all of the welfare concerns, for example, with deer stalking, with using dogs to search and locate for wild mammals. So it's very much about ensuring that a permitted activity is where dogs are used. It's addressing how the person is using the dogs. So some people will conduct that activity on quad bikes, on foot, on horses. There will be various different ways, but what this bill is addressing is if they're doing those activities and dogs are involved, how can dogs be used and what are you permitted and not permitted to do with the dogs?
Thank you. And finally, and again, thinking of welfare concerns and the aims that lie behind the piece of legislation, you mentioned how the existing legislation relates or doesn't relate effectively to the police officers and the judicial process. How do you feel that the new legislation would make this more justiciable, if that's the right word, or more appropriate when it comes to how it's dealt with by the police?
So when they spoke to the police, some of the issues they sort of identified that we've addressed in the bill would be in terms of definition of cover. So the intention is that as soon as an animal is flushed from cover, then it is humanely dispatched. And that was one of the areas that was open to a lot of debate in the existing Act as to what constituted cover. And if that was kind of being disputed, then it could be hard to establish whether somebody was illegally hunting because they would say, well, the animal is still in cover, so I'm still flushing. Other people would have a different view and say, you should have taken steps to have shot the animal at that point because it had emerged from cover. We also sort of addressed guess, some of the welfare issues and issues in Police Scotland by redefining the definition of wild mammal to include rabbits. So that was an issue that was being raised both on welfare grounds, excluding rabbits from the Act, but also it was providing a route whereby hair coursers were sort of exploiting that as a loophole and saying, you know, police had very strong suspicions that they were out hair coursing. They were like, no, I was hunting rabbits. My dog got confused and it, you know, accidentally killed a hare instead of a rabbit. So now we're kind of making it clear that, you know, whether your dog, you know, hunts and kills a hare or a rabbit, both of those are offences.
Thank you.
Anne Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. So you broadly responded to most of my questions, but Minister Mary McCallum stated that chasing and killing a mammal with a dog for sport or otherwise has no place in modern Scotland. And this view is shared by 77% of Scottish public, who said in response to a 2019 poll that the existing legislation to protect animals from hunting needs to be strengthened. It's important to remember that protecting animal welfare is a key concern for many people and is a key driver for this bill. Can I ask why the name of the bill is Hunting with Dogs when the name of the previous Act, the Protection of Wild Mammals, better reflects the animal welfare motivation?
A lot of debate about that. My SGLD colleagues might want to say a little bit more if I kind of miss any of the key points. I think it kind of came down to how we define hunting. So hunting does include elements of chasing and killing, but also, you know, stalking and flushing. So what we have set out to do is take the approach that hunting is permitted, but these are the parameters under which it's done, and that, you know, hunting wild mammals, if you're using dogs, then, you know, chasing and killing is not part of that, but other elements such as the stalking and flushing are. So I understand that some people have concerns about that, but I think we're very clear that this is being brought forward to ensure that where dogs are used to search for or flush wild mammals, it's done in a humane way, and that, you know, hunting, as in the elements that involve chasing and killing, are not permitted. They weren't permitted under the existing legislation, and they are certainly not permitted under this legislation.
Thanks. I mean, it seems odd to me. I mean, so we have an Act that's about protecting wild mammals, and this bill will replace it entirely?
Yeah.
No? Yes? No?
I think it's also important to realise that there are a number of Acts of Parliament that are about protecting wild
animals.
That's
what I was wondering.
So,
yeah.
I mean, you know, the Wildlife and Countryside Act and the Conservation Regulations, the Protection of Badgers Act and so on. So this is specifically about the use of dogs.
Okay.
And I think it's quite important that that's clear to people, that if they want to know about how they can use dogs in this context, this is where the appropriate legislation sits.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Jim Fairley.
Yeah, thanks very much, Commissioner. I just want to go back slightly, Leah, if you don't mind, to what you were saying about flushing. In the policy memorandum, in section 21 of the policy memorandum, it says, Lord Bonamy's quote is saying, in general, 20% more of foxes disturbed by hunts are killed in this way by hounds. And he noted that there were legitimate grounds for suspicion that present arrangements were providing cover for unlawful use of dogs, contrary to the intention of the Act, and illegally raising the concerns of welfare of foxes and other wildlife. And one of the things that was mentioned in there was the fact that sometimes a fox would be killed before it was flushed, so while it was still in cover. So can I just get an understanding of what you mean, or when, if a fox was killed and the purpose of this is to stop them being chased through open countryside, doesn't that kind of defeat the argument, in that if people are finding a loophole, if a fox is killed while it's still in cover, there's very little you can do about that? Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think, so you've sort of tried to look at how hunting is done. So, you know, the reason for using dogs is to flush, you know, an animal from cover, because yeah. otherwise you would just be able to shoot the animal. If you can see the animal clearly, you don't need to use dogs because yeah. you can take a clear shot. So the flushing from cover is to address the issue of where the fox is concealed in such a way that you can't take a shot. But, you know, when you look at how somebody who's carrying out wildlife management, you know, mm-hmm. is doing it, they will take the first opportunity where they can safely and humanely dispatch that animal. Okay. When people are carrying out illegal hunting, you know, they don't want to, you know, the animal to be there. They want the chase element of it, hare coursing, for example. So okay. they will seek to flush.
So that's my point. They're not really breaking the law by deliberately allowing a fox to escape. And I'm going to continue with foxes because that's where a lot of the concern with this is. So they're not breaking the law if a fox is killed before it escapes, because the purpose, as you've just said, is to actually have the hunt. I fully understand the problem that we have if a fox escapes and they go, hey, Tyler Hill, we're off, and they go and start chasing a fox around the countryside. Would that not be alleviated by having more guns and making sure there was at least a minimum number of guns to make sure that that fox never gets past a line of guns? Would that not cover that problem?
So, yeah, as I said, so just sort of make it clear what we're trying to eliminate is the chase element. So if yeah. you can dispatch a fox, you know, that's sitting
as
in front of
as
you
possible.
Without
okay,
that.
So let me give you the scenario. If you've got a pack of dogs hunting a copse and a fox is flushed, but you've got two guns standing 75 yards either side and the fox goes through the middle, you've got to get after it. So I can understand that that's a loophole. I can understand that that would cause genuine concern. But if you've got a copse and you've got dogs hunting it through, by and large, most foxes will never ever see the hounds because they're on their way out of the other end. If you've got 10 guns along the top, that fox isn't going to get past the guns. Therefore, it's dead before the hounds are anywhere near it. Would that not have satisfied the problem of chasing across open countryside?
That is something that has been brought up. I'm not sure how you would practically mandate a set number of guns. I'm not saying it couldn't be done.
If you're licensing a hunt to control a predator, surely part of the license should be, and when you're hunting, you must have a minimum number for a specific area. Now, that could be worked by practical land managers. And if the loss of hounds or horses or anything else is the penalty for them failing to do that, I would have thought if the measures were so strict for them, they're going to make sure that they comply with the law.
We're still developing the licensing scheme, so we can certainly take a note of that and, you know, consider whether having one of the conditions of the licensing scheme, something, as you suggested, would be possible or not, so we can have a look into that.
OK. Thank you. I'll move on from there. Under what circumstances the Scottish Government would consider it to be appropriate to make use of this exception? So we're talking about the exception for the two-dog rule. For example, what circumstances would constitute serious damage to livestock, woodlands or crops? And under what circumstances it would be appropriate for the use of exception for protecting human health and preventing the spread of disease? So basically we're saying, why would there be exceptions? What would be the grounds under which there would be exceptions? Can you give us a kind of broad outline of what you're trying
I
to achieve
can.
There?
So for where we don't have a specific definition within the Act, then we would sort of rely on the ordinary meaning of the word. So serious damage would be damage that, you know, was considered not to be sort of minor or negligible. So if you think probably the issue that we're all aware of in Scotland is the serious damage that deer can do to woodland. So deer are obviously controlled and dogs can sometimes be used. So when we're talking kind of serious damage to you know, woodland, then I think deer would be a good example.
Okay. Hugh, you clearly want to come in there.
Well, I was just going to say that the licensing provisions here clearly are designed to mirror the licensing provisions which are already in existence in Section 16 of the Wildlife and Countryside Act, mm-hmm. where that term, the prevention of serious damage, is used. So it's a concept that the licensing authority are already familiar with. And so, ultimately, it is a matter of judgment for them. But there have been sort of, I've been involved in discussions in the past, for example, over the potential licensing of control of buzzards around pheasant pens. And that was something which didn't really get anywhere in the end. But a sort of benchmark figure that was accepted by the land managers and by the licensing authority at the time was something like 10% of sort of losses. So that sort of thing might be something which could... I mean, so I'm not saying that that would inevitably have to be the figure, but there'll be work by the licensing authority looking at specific cases and bearing in mind that this is a concept which is used across the whole range of licensing to assess what constituted serious damage.
OK. I'm going to look at it from a sheep farmer's point of view, given my background as a sheep farmer.
Yeah.
Serious damage to a sheep farmer is when a fox is coming in and lifting lambs, either killing lambs and taking tails and ears as trinkets for cubs, or killing lambs to feed young cubs, or just killing for their own food. 10% is a colossal figure for a sheep farmer to have lost to a fox kill. Having been on the receiving end of that kind of killing, I'm well aware of the distress that that causes, not only to your lamb in percentage, but also to you as the shepherd sheep farmer going out every morning and getting these kills. So one of the things that slightly concerns me about this area is the licensing being granted. To me, serious damage is anything where a fox is predating pens, environmental issues, well, that'll come on later on. Who decides what is serious damage? Because the person who's actually in the position of looking after the livestock, whatever it is it's in their charge. If Nature Scott comes back and says, well, we don't consider that a serious damage, how do you come to a balance of that?
Well, as I say, I mean, ultimately it will be a decision for the licensing authority. And, of course, you know, those decisions can be challenged through court process, but I'm not saying that's a route that people are naturally going to want to be going down. But it will be a matter for discussion between the licence applicant and the licensing authority. So, I mean, if, for example, there are losses which mean that your business is unsustainable, clearly that is serious damage. On the other hand, there may be some losses which are considered part of usual business risk. So again, I think these are things which will need to be worked out in the process of setting up the licensing scheme as to what in particular circumstances amounts to serious damage for a particular type of business in particular circumstances. I don't think it would be appropriate for us to give a hard and fast rule or to try and preempt the decisions of the licensing authority at this stage. But I think what we are trying to get at is that this is a serious step. We believe that the use of more than two dogs presents a real danger to not only to the mammal which might be being hunted or pursued or controlled, but also to other wildlife, and that we want to make sure that that serious step is only taken where it can be justified. So we are looking at a number of conditions, for example, that other potential avenues are explored before that license is granted, and that license is granted in circumstances which do amount to a serious situation. But I fully accept that what constitutes a serious situation may vary from business to business and from one circumstance to another. That's why I don't think it's possible for us to say at this stage what it might be, but it would need to be a reflection of the fact that we think that this is not a default step, that licensing of the use of more than two dogs is a serious step and something which requires proper consideration by the licensing authority.
Okay, thanks very much, Convener, and I will let you come back in on timing of license at a later point.
It's just a pick up something that Hugh Dignan said to Jim there. You mentioned an appeal process, but within this bill there is no provision for an appeal process. And if you're going to argue that it's part of consultation to do with licensing, then the financial memorandum says there are no costs on other bodies, individuals and businesses arising from the provisions of the bill. So therefore, why have you separated that and made that comment within the bill, but then also have omitted, or is it an oversight in drafting of the bill that you've omitted the appeal process for farmers, for example, who
from what Jim has questioned, yeah, are going to experience severe loss.
I'm sorry if I've sort of misled you there. There isn't an appeal process in the bill. I was talking about there are processes by which a decision can be challenged through judicial review and also, of course, by the internal complaints process of Nature Scott. There isn't an appeal process in this bill in the same way that there aren't appeal processes for any other licensing procedures that which are present in things like the Wildlife and Countryside Act or in the Nature Conservation Regulations. And, you know, we are following that precedent at this stage, but I suppose it is fair to say that the whole range of licensing operations, the way licensing is carried out by Nature Scott, is the subject of quite a major review, which is part of the Butte House Agreement and the Programme for Government.
Thanks.
So, yeah.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Alistair Allen to go back to the section 1 and 2 of the bill on offences. Alistair.
Thank you, Convener. I was just really to ask about rabbits, since they got a mention earlier on in your contribution, and how the bill has been drafted to avoid any unintended consequences around that. I mean, the obvious one is the example of a dog that slips its lead and chases after a rabbit. Is that captured by the bill, or does the bill deal with that scenario?
So I think, as I said sort of earlier, because of the way we framed the bill, that hunting is defined as, you know, it's a person who hunts. So they hunt using a dog, not the dog. So we're not structured in such a way that accidental, we accept accidental chasing will go on with, you know, dogs, pet dogs in the park. We've all kind of seen them sort of, you know, taken off occasionally. That's not an offence under this Act if somebody is, you know, deliberately hunting. Or, for example, if somebody was out walking their dog started chasing a wild mammal and they just let it happen, you know, sat down and just, you know, took no steps to, you know, try and recall their dog or, you know, stop it, you know, carrying that out, then potentially, and it would be obviously up to the courts and the prosecution, that, you know, could be deemed as deliberate hunting, because although they didn't set out with that intention, a hunt has, you know, developed and they've taken no actions to stop it. But, you know, not where it is a genuine accident, as you said, the dog slips a lead and catches a rabbit before anybody can do anything to stop it.
And can I ask, finally, Convener, just related to that, again, on rabbits, just some indication as to why the bill is framed with reference to rabbits the way it is, and how you're making sure of avoiding unintended consequences. I'm thinking of pest control here and avoiding leaving people thinking that they have other options, probably less palatable in terms of welfare than this. So I'm just curious to know why the bill was framed the way it is around rabbits, with regard to pest control in mind.
So rabbits were originally were excluded from the 2002 Act. So that meant that while you were not permitted to allow a dog to chase and kill a hare, you could allow a dog to chase and kill a rabbit. So that has obviously welfare implications. Rabbits and hares are very similar, and if we're saying there are, you know, serious welfare grounds and, you know, reasons that you would not allow a dog to kill a hare, then I think it, you know, seems illogical to exclude rabbits. As I said, also we kind of have evidence that people were carrying out hare coursing under the guise of rabbit control, and obviously hare coursing, it's a serious crime, and we're seeking to, you know, close any loopholes to stop that activity happening. So those were the reasons for, you know, bringing rabbits within the definition of wild mammal when they were previously excluded.
Just on that, so really the only reason you brought in rabbits is to stop hare coursing, because right across the country, every single day of the year, there'll be a young farmer who'll go out hunting rabbits, maybe with his dogs, not only as pest control, because rabbits in many places can be defined as a pest, where hares certainly can't be, and those rabbits are a source of income as well. So Is that type of hunting going to be feel the impact of this just to close a loophole over ear coursing?
No, not at all. As I said, you know, it's welfare as well. But there is nothing in this Act that stops people going out and, you know, controlling rabbits and using dogs to do so. The only thing that this Act is stopping them doing, which they could do previously, is allowing the dog to kill the rabbit. So they will have to shoot the rabbit or use another permitted method of dispatch. But the reasons that you talked about, for example, going out and taking a rabbit home for the dinner pot, you can still do that. You can still go out and take your dogs out with you. You just need to, you know, shoot the rabbit.
Okay. Very small supplementary.
Sorry, I'm just going to press you on that point. Are we specifically talking about guys who ferret rabbits and then allow lurchers to kill them? Is that what you're trying to stop?
No, as I said, we're, you know, trying to close down a loophole whereby people will go out, you know, hair coursing, claim that they were hunting rabbits, or to acknowledge the welfare implications. But where people are, you know, carrying out legitimate rabbit control, that is still permitted. We're just sort of caveating that and saying when you're doing that control, you have to make sure that if there are dogs involved, and not everybody who hunts rabbits uses dogs, that the dogs are not permitted to chase and kill the rabbit. So is that one element of it?
Okay, I'm slightly confused now because there is a genuine method of controlling a warren. If a warren is sitting right beside an arable plantation and they want to clear that warren out so that you don't get crop damage, quite often what a keeper will do is he'll have a couple of lurchers or two or three lurchers or a terrier, whatever dogs it is. Ferrets will go down, they'll flush the rabbit out. Now, with the best will in the world, rabbits can come out three and four at a time and the dogs will get them. You're not going to just stand there with a gun and go bang, 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 because it's just not feasible to do it because you've got a gun in your hand. Would that then become illegal under this Act?
There was a question which occurred to me at the time, and I had some discussions with BASC, as you know, British Association of Shooting Conservation. Yeah. And their view was that sort of activity you were talking about was very rare nowadays, that most people would use guns, that they would put ferrets down into a warren or into rabbit holes and shoot
net or
shoot
gun
rabbits.
Rather than shoot with dogs.
But yes, I mean killing rabbits with dogs would not be lawful.
Okay, thank you. Just so we're clear on that point.
I am very confused about this as well. I mean, hair coursing, could, you know, those people who carry out that without permission on land that they haven't got permission for, would it not have been simpler to have just kept the existing exclusion for rabbits but that required landowner permission? So do you not think that a hair courser, if they were caught, is going to use the would they be able to use that defence still within this bill of hunting for something else?
Anybody can go out and say that they're hunting for something else, but if, you know, that hunt is deemed not to have been, you know, conducted, so if their dog is found to have, you know, chased and killed a rabbit or a hare, then they will, you know, potentially be guilty of an offence. And as I said, it's not just about the hair coursing, there is the welfare element as well. This is a bill where we sought to address welfare issues, and it seemed quite anomalous that you're not permitted to use dogs to kill hares, but you could use them to kill rabbits.
Are you worried that this is being rolled in, this intention to try to sort out hair coursing within this, which is called hunting with dogs, rather than looking at the Wildlife and Countryside Act 1981?
So prosecutions are brought in terms of hair coursing under this Act. So as I said, we have, you know, had discussions with the Crown, and we have had discussions with the police, and you know, it was Police Scotland who did raise the issue of mammals being, you know, rabbits being excluded from the definition of mammal, and that, you know, can sometimes frustrate them in their efforts to deal with hair coursers. So we listened to the views of stakeholders, and as I said, we sought to address the welfare issues as well.
Okay, I know I'm going on, but I just want to make this point. So to deal with the issue of hair coursing, which there are not many prosecutions in Scotland whatsoever. We're rolling it into this, and we're bringing in rabbits, which are killed as an effective measure to protect livestock and used for the pot. I just think it's just really strange, and I think we need some more clarification on that, but not now, because I know we haven't got time.
Thank you. Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Okay. Thanks, Convener. Just in the in part one, it's still around the definition of wild mammal, and I'm just interested to understand why a rat and a mouse are not included in that definition in the interest of all animals being sentient.
So, again, that was something that we considered and we had discussions with stakeholders. And I think in the responses that your committee received, the Animal Welfare Commission made the point, as other stakeholders have made, that although, you know, it might kind of seem to be quite unpalatable because of the way that the physiology of rats and mice, that a well-trained terrier is probably capable of dispatching them in a more humane manner when you compare it with some of the other legal and permitted methods such as rodenticides. And there's been a lot of research published recently which kind of ranks the different ways of killing rodents in terms of what is, you know, deemed to be humane, and I think rodenticides kind of are sort of there at the bottom. So accepting that it is necessary sometimes for people to, you know, control rats and mice, you know, particularly for reasons of public health or to protect agriculture, then I think we came down on reflection on the view that continue to exclude them would not bring the same welfare concerns that compared to other animals which are included within the definition.
Thanks very much. That's very helpful clarity.
We can now move on to questions on section 3 of the bill. Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, colleagues, and good morning, panel. I just would like a bit of explanation as to the reasons for introducing the two-dog limit. I think it would be useful to have an explanation on that point, and also an indication of how that limit has worked in England and Wales.
As you'll be aware, this was something which we talked about and thought about in a sort of post-Bonamy. The review, and I think it was one of these things, as I said earlier, where we reflected on how the legislation had worked in Scotland and how there was a perception that hunting was still going on despite the fact it was apparently banned by the 2002 Act, and we were concerned that not only were there issues around the language and the consistency of the way that was framed in the legislation, but also about really the potential exploitation of loopholes by people who were determined to frustrate the legislation. And we also were aware that there were genuine issues around the ability of anyone to really significantly control a pack of dogs. So a number of these issues came together and we, you know, freely admit that we looked at how it worked in other countries, and we thought that this would be a way of dealing with some of those issues. It would mean that it would greatly reduce the risk of a pack of dogs not being in sufficient control and being allowed to, or not being allowed to, but in effect chasing and killing mammals. We also thought that it would reduce the potential impact on other wildlife where dogs were used. So, you know, whether it's other mammals in a piece of woodland or birds or nesting birds or so on. So there were issues around that. And I guess it was really to address primarily the welfare issues, which were identified by Lord Bonamy, where he said a significant number of foxes were still being killed by dogs, despite the fact that the legislation had attempted to put an end to that. So this was really an additional measure that we thought was necessary to address that issue. In terms of how it's, I don't know if you want me to go on and say how it's addressed, how it's worked in other countries, we're aware that it hasn't been hugely popular at all, with particularly with upland sheep farmers in other parts of Great Britain. Farmers in the north of England and in Wales have complained about that. And it was with that in mind that we developed the licensing scheme, so that where there were no other realistic options for farmers to protect livestock, that we would have this ability to license the use of more than two dogs where that met the conditions which are set out in legislation in terms of preventing serious damage and being no other potential options for dealing with that issue.
And so in deciding the limit and thinking of predatory control and the issues that Jim Fairley's already raised, what consideration was given to the welfare of farm animals? And, for example, if a situation arose that needed, immediate attention and license, you know, getting the license might not always be possible, what consideration was given to that?
Well, I mean, it's clearly a high consideration. I mean, the purpose of preventing damage to livestock is really one of the sort of key issues around allowing the use of dogs to control predators. And so we absolutely recognise that it's very important. It's very important from a business point of view. But we also know how distressing it is to farmers to lose stock. That's a point that's been made to us, not just in this context, but in the context of other sorts of predators, avian predators, and as well as mammalian predators. So we're very well aware of that. In terms of how quickly one can get a license, well, I think NatureScot have greatly improved their systems and are now pretty decent at turning around license applications quite quickly. I was thinking the other day about the Raven licensing scheme, which some farmers will be familiar with, where they've lost stock, lambs and calves, to ravens. And there was a lot of criticism at the time about the speed with which NatureScot were able to produce licenses for that. But they have really brought that down by encouraging people who are expecting to have a problem to get an application in early, by ensuring that they are familiar with the circumstances on particular farms and the particular environment and the particular situation, and whether what sort of forms of predator control are likely to be available. So I think there is good reason to think that NatureScot will be able to produce licences where they are justified in good order, in time to prevent serious damage rather than reacting to serious damage. And that, after all, is really the main objective here, to prevent serious damage.
I think it's also worth making the point that it will only be a licence that will be required if you wish to use more than two dogs. So if people need to take immediate action, then they have the option of other permitted methods, so in flock control, for example, lamping, or they can also use two dogs. So yes, they might want to apply for a licence, but they will still be able to, you know, undertake other methods of predator control while they're waiting for that licence application to be considered.
Thank you.
Just some supplementaries. It's been suggested the only reason for bringing in a two-dog limit is actually to absolutely stop the traditional hunting with packs. That is the only reason. It's not actually down to animal welfare. But my question is, are you confident there's enough expertise within NatureScot to decide under the licensing whether three dogs, five dogs, six dogs, 11 dogs are the most animal welfare friendly number of dogs to use in respect of individual applications? And also, where will these licences apply? So in some land ownership, you might find that in some places three dogs is appropriate, and in other places it might be 11 dogs. Will individual landowners have to apply for multiple licences to cover different types of land to ensure that the best method of humanely controlling pests is undertaken?
So the bill kind of sets out the overarching principles of how the licensing scheme will operate, but we very much expect that it will be built upon. So there'll be detailed accompanying guidance and further operational administrative elements of the scheme will be developed, and you know, that will very much done in conjunction with stakeholders. We want a licensing scheme, you know, that is simple, it's straightforward, that people understand what the licence scheme allows them to do, how they apply. So, you know, the next step of this process will be that NatureScot sitting down with the people who will actually be the ones who will be seeking to apply for the licensing scheme and working with them to work through these questions, identify if there are evidence gaps that need to be addressed, consider these kind of issues, what sort of evidence should be brought to bear, and we kind of see that as very much being that collaborative approach with stakeholders to make a licensing scheme that not only meets the objectives of the bill but also works for the people who will be applying for and operating under it.
Okay, a short supplementary from Jim Fairley.
It might not be that short, convener.
It'll need to be. We're fast running out of time, okay. I'm afraid.
Hugh, I very much take up your point about licensing for raven control. I had a severe problem with ravens, and when we started off the licensing process, it was clunky, it took too much time, and the damage that was done in the interim was too much. But they very quickly got their act together, and the licensing worked a treat. Different with ravens from foxes. Because a raven, you can do control, and it's a different method of control. I would suggest that licensing for fox control prior to lambing is the important period, not during lambing, because we don't need proof that foxes kill lambs. They do. And we don't need proof that the damage that they'll do is anything other than a reality. So the licensing period, first of all, shouldn't be for a short 14-day period. It should be over a season to allow landowners, farmers, tenants to make sure that they've got numbers under control as much as they can. Because, Leo, with the best will in the world, and I don't mean this to be derogatory, lamping a fox is not an easy thing to do. It takes a lot of skill, it takes a lot of time. You've got to know where the movements of the fox are. But if you have a licensing scheme where you can control what you know is going to be a predator to your stock prior to lambing starting, then you're already halfway there. If you wait till after lambing has started, the whole disruption then is about your lambing fields and your lambing parks. So I would urge you to consider how you're going to create this license. It shouldn't be 14 days and it shouldn't be during the lambing period.
Would you like to briefly comment on that, or well, we'll just take it as a statement?
No, I mean, certainly that's obviously we'll listen to all of the evidence sessions, and different people have different views on the appropriateness of the 14 days. But we picked 14 days because we thought, as we said, we kind of see this licensing scheme. It can't just be a way of allowing to what is happening to continue to happen. There needs to be clear parameters around it. I think you're right that farms will have already very good evidence of the damage that foxes can cause to sheep. So, you know, I would hope that in those situations they should be able to, you know, produce that evidence already, which would allow NatureScot to make those decisions quite quickly. We felt that 14 days was a reasonable amount. It struck the balance between having a licensing system that was practical but also stopping people being able to exploit that licensing system and just using it as a way of sort of carrying on the activities that are happening at the moment that we know that are resulting in wild mammals, whether accidentally or otherwise, being killed with dogs. So we wanted to have some good strong controls on it, but obviously, as I said, we know there are different views on what the date should be, and we'll listen to what is said in other evidence sessions.
I genuinely accept the wildlife management and the welfare of ours. I absolutely take that on board, but there's got to be a practical solution to this.
Thank you. Move on to Jenny Minto.
Thank you, convener, and thank you, panel. If I may, can I just briefly continue on this line, because I too have had concerns raised with me around about the licensing system. But I think people accept that there's got to be the balance to make the application licence difficult enough to stop people, I suppose, abusing the licence system, but also easy enough for, as Jim Fairley has been talking about, farmers at an incredibly busy time. So, and I also think we need to listen to the different needs across Scotland. Not everybody walks their dog in a park, for example. They could be walking it in woodland and raise a hare or raise rabbits. So I think it's recognising that across Scotland you've got different terrains and different ways of people working, and so really continuing on from Jim Fairley's plea that there is a listening to the welfare needs of farmers and the animals as well, and a balance is made there. My question is specifically around about section 3.3e and the bringing in of birds of prey to kill wild mammals. I'm just interested to know what you had in mind there when you were writing this piece of legislation.
Yeah, so obviously we sort of speak a lot about the use of dogs and talked a lot about the use of dogs in terms of fox control, but dogs are used in a variety of wildlife management situations. All of the provisions in the bill and all of the licensing provisions have to address when people are using dogs, for example, in deer stalking or falconry. So this was something that I didn't have a lot of knowledge about before I embarked on this bill, but what happens in falconry, which is a permitted method of hunting in Scotland, so long as you do it in adhere to the Wildlife and Countryside Act or the various other bits of legislation. But what a falconer will do, so they will go out with their bird of prey and they will take a couple of dogs along with them, and the purpose is, if you think about a bird of prey, and you've probably all seen a bird patiently waiting in a field for hours and hours and hours for a rabbit or a hare to emerge from cover. If you were to go out there with your falcons, you could be stuck there for a very long time and nothing happening. So they will bring one or two dogs along, and what the dog will do is just flush that prey from cover, and then it means that that bird has got that immediate sight and it will swoop down and it will kill the target prey. So it's in Scotland, it's kind of rabbits and hares are the sort of the main prey mammals that for falconers. So, as I said, this bill is not seeking to address any issues in relation to hunting. People have different views on hunting. We are purely looking at where people are carrying out legitimate activities, be that deer stalking or falconry, and they are using dogs, how dogs are permitted to be used. So all of the kind of the references for and falcons are what we're thinking in the context of when people are going out doing falconry, where not as far as we're aware is there anybody out there kind of using falcon birds of prey to catch foxes, or as part of fox control they're kind of using them in the art of falconry, and that's what we're addressing.
Okay. Thank you, because I was that. Thank you for that clarification. If I may, can I ask as well? Section E finishes as soon as reasonably possible, whereas I believe in the 2002 Act there was a mixture of as soon as possible or when it was safe to do so. So I'm interested to ask why the reasonably has been inserted.
So, yeah, there were a lot of inconsistencies with exactly as you kind of made, which made it difficult and made people question whether different provisions were setting slightly different bars. So we sought to have a sort of a clarification and use the same words when we were talking about the same thing, and kind of reasonably possible. We kind of just sought to have language that was as modern, as easy to understand as possible, and aligned with other wildlife legislation. And that was the formulation that we felt kind of best met the objectives.
Okay, because I suppose as soon as possible is a clear statement, but if the reasonably has been brought in to align with other acts, then I suppose that's reasonable.
Okay, thank you. We're going to move on to questions on section 5 of the bill. Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel today. I'd like to ask a couple of questions in regards to the management of wild animals below ground. And I would just like to know, what is the Scottish Government's understanding of the circumstances where it may be appropriate or necessary to use a dog below ground?
Okay, so, yeah, this is probably one of the, I think, most polarising issues of this bill about the use of dogs below ground. I think, as we tried to do throughout the Act, we tried to look at where the activity is carrying on. Is it still sort of reasonable? Are there still reasons why we would want to permit that activity? And if so, how do we ensure it's done in a way that is as humane and effective as possible? So, kind of listening to stakeholders, there are incidences where a fox will go to ground, and in those cases, terriers might be used to flush that animal from below ground in order that it can then be humanely dispatched. And it was an issue that was also kind of addressed by Lord Bonamy, and we kind of followed his recommendations in that we have sought to allow that to continue, because we recognise that in some circumstances it helps to facilitate, legitimate predator control and deal with some of the sort of, issues in terms of, fox predation that we've discussed. But we sought to, as Bonamy recommended, bring in a one dog limit to also address the welfare concerns that have been raised about sending a dog underground. So, again, we've kind of set out in the bill the circumstances under which a dog could be used underground and how that is done, but it was trying to find that balance between stakeholders who are very much opposed to it on welfare ground and other stakeholders who very much are making a case that it's a necessary point of predator control, which is why we've kind of tightened up the provisions to say this is how it could be done in a way that hopefully meets both of those objectives.
Can I ask you, touched upon there introducing the limit of one dog, what were some of the welfare concerns?
I think just that the concerns were that the more dogs that you send underground, then the greater the risk that one or more dogs would break from its training, and rather than just simply alert the dog handlers to the location of the fox, that a fight might break out. Mm-hmm. So it was it was welfare to kind of limit the risk of a dog killing a fox, was to kind of limit it to one dog. And I said that was kind of the recommendation that Lord Bonamy made.
That's great. Thank you.
There is no provision for a licence to allow more than one dog. But if Nature Scott were to look at a situation where it would be more humane or more safe, or it was safer with animal welfare considerations to use more than one dog, why wouldn't that be possible? It seems very prescriptive just to say one dog, that's it. If there were situations, why wouldn't a licence ensure that the highest of welfare standards were upheld?
So one dog is the limit in England and Wales. That's been the limit since 2004. The Code of Practice for Terriers says that, pretty much in almost all circumstances, only one dog should be used, and Lord Bonamy recommended it. And as I said, the stakeholders, a lot of them are very much say that there are welfare considerations if you send, even one dog underground. So taking all of that into account, then we went for that hard one dog limit.
Okay, thank you. Rachel Hamilton, do you have a supplementary?
Well, I just wanted to question you on the fact that there's a contradictory element within the bill that says that you're prohibiting the involvement of two dogs in an accepted activity, but envisaging that more than two dogs could be involved. And involved is the important word here. Because would it be possible for you to explain what is understood by a dog being involved in an activity, and why those provisions are contradictory?
Sorry, which provision were you?
So within the bill, it and I haven't got the reference, but it's to the section, but it the bill prohibits the involvement of more than two dogs in an accepted activity, but it envisages that more than two dogs could be involved and then taking reasonable steps to ensure that more than two dogs could not come together to form a pack. So it's that bit where the dogs come together in an unintended consequence.
So, yeah, so if you, for example, have somebody who is going out using their dogs to flush foxes, and they're going out there with two dogs, and they go out in the field and then they happen upon somebody else who's there with their two dogs, then they have to take reasonable steps to make sure those dogs don't form a pack, and it was to stop... We have that in to basically stop people who are seeking to, you know, should they seek to kind of circumvent the two-dog limit by kind of claiming that, oh, you know, I was out with my two dogs, my friend was out with two dogs, we were all just out with two dogs, but suddenly you've got, you know, 10 people and 20 dogs together, and that's a pack. So it's to just make it clear that if you're not acting under a licence, you're only permitted to use two dogs, and then you have to make reasonable steps to make sure that your dogs do not, you know, join up with other dogs and, you know, form that inadvertent pack.
Well, through land reform, obviously, there is that, Countryside Act, which allows people to walk. So what if a person was walking, two people were walking across a hill, and they each had one dog, and that those dogs, would they then be taken to court?
No, because they wouldn't
be... If they joined the other dogs?
No, because they wouldn't be hunting. So it's only in the context of hunting.
But what if the dog in its natural state... which dogs were obviously bred in that sense, and that's been evolution has taken us to the domestication of pets. However, they have a natural instinct. So in a court of law, what happens?
That would be up to ultimately the police and the prosecution to determine whether, you know, somebody had acted in contravention of the Act. But the intention of the Act is not to stop two people out walking their dogs. And we've already said that if a dog, you know, accidentally was to slip the leash and chase a wild mammal, then, you know, we wouldn't consider that to be an offence. But where people are going out with the intention of hunting and taking two dogs with them, if they do not have a licence, they have to make sure that if they come across other hunters who are also out with their dogs, that they do not, you know, accidentally or deliberately, you know, end up working together, and you then have a situation where you've got six people and six hunting dogs.
Okay. Do you want me to ask my actual question?
Jim has got a short question.
Yeah, it's a very short one. Okay. I think I understand what it is that you're trying to do here, that there will be people who will try to circumvent the law. And if they say, oh, yeah, we're going to this bit over here and we'll have two dogs, and we're going to this bit over here and we'll have two dogs, and they just happen to get together, that's them deliberately trying to circumvent the law. Is that the bit that you're trying to stop?
That's what we're trying to stop. We're trying to stop that
Thank
loophole
you.
From happening.
Thank you. We're now moving on to Section 6. Jenny Mint has got a question.
Thank you. Kind of further on to my previous questions about using birds. You gave the exceptions with regards to falconry. I'm interested to hear the reasons for game shooting and deer stalking and how dogs are used in the context of that to make them exceptions.
In deer stalking, so what, and this is very much kind of set out in the code of practice produced by Nature Scotland, and also when you kind of look at the best practice by the likes of Basque, you will go out there and your intention is to shoot the deer. Now, that should happen, but occasionally, despite the best efforts, and a deer may be injured rather than killed outright. And in those circumstances, the deer stalkers will then use that dog to track that injured deer so that they can find it and humanely dispatch it. So it's very much dogs are being used in those contexts to ensure that deer stalking is done in a way where deer welfare is utmost. And as I said, that's kind of considered best practice, and I think pretty much all or most deer stalkers will take dogs for them, but it's for that purpose. It's primarily if a deer is injured. In terms of other kind of game shooting, so Yeah, again, you know, you are allowed, if you wish to, you know, hunt certain mammals within Scotland. So rabbits and hares are kind of traditional, are the sort of the traditional game mammals in Scotland. And, you know, people will hunt them for food purposes, for example. And they sometimes, not always, but sometimes, again, they'll take a dog or two dogs out with them to help them locate and flush those mammals so that they can shoot them. So those are permitted activities. So, as I said, we're not kind of seeking through this bill to address any of the issues. We're just saying that where hunting is permitted and those people carrying out hunting activities are using dogs, this is how they have to conduct themselves.
Okay, thank you for that. So with regards to the deer, then it's supporting the welfare of the injured animal to ensure that they are put out of their suffering as humanely as possible.
Yes, and dogs are obviously much more effective at finding and following, you know, those kind of trails than people are, so it allows it to happen much quicker than if the person didn't have the dogs with them.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. We're going to move on to Section 7 and Rachel Hamilton's questions then. And if you could also cover your questions in Section 4, 8 and 9, please.
I'll try my best, Convener. Just to pick up on Jenny Minto's point and what you said there, Leah, 11,000 out of 30,000 deer shot in Scotland through Scottish Government schemes are done at night with lamps. And how do police look at that activity if, in the terms of injury in the, you know, all these forests that we have where we need to control deer, how do they monitor that, particularly if only one season out of a whole year there is ample sight to make sure that there is no injury?
I think that would be a question that would be better put to Police Scotland in terms of how they would monitor those activities. We have very clear guidance and regulations about night shooting of deer and what the requirements of that are. But I think that's kind of more, you know, done through the Deer Scotland Act.
But this is part of the bill, because Jenny Mint has just asked about that.
Yeah, the activity... if you're taking dogs with you to, you know, locate injured deer, is covered by this. But the more general, you know, hunting of deer is covered by other legislation.
Could I just add? I don't think we've got any evidence that people are using dogs to pursue and attack deer. Dogs in deer stalking are used primarily or exclusively for the sort of welfare purposes that Leah is outlining. I mean, I'm sure there are some poachers that use lurchers and things to attack deer, and that's an offence and always has been and will continue to be. But I don't think we've got any concerns about forest rangers and people carrying out deer management activities using dogs unlawfully. We're just being clear in this bill that the current use, the way that they use dogs, is lawful and it will continue to be lawful.
Mm. Okay, moving on to Section 7. Why is the licence to protect livestock limited to a maximum of 14 days in a consecutive 14-day period, but a licence in respect of a scheme for environmental benefit can be granted up for 2 years in a consecutive 2-year period?
So when we were kind of talking about the environment purpose, we're kind of very much thinking of the types of schemes that we gave examples of in the policy memorandum. So there is a currently a stoat eradication programme going on in Orkney, and dogs are being used, and that's a long running scheme. It's expected to run for the next, you know, I think it's 5 years initially. So it's those kind of established long-running schemes where you've got, like, you know, a purpose, which is, in this case, to eradicate all of the stoats on Orkney for environmental reasons. So for that, we kind of thought it wouldn't be practical or effective to have the people who are carrying out that programme, where you've got a stated aim and people are out, you know, potentially every other day looking for stoats, to have to apply for a licence every 14 days. So that was why we kind of felt 2 years was reasonable. And again, that kind of ties in with some other licensing provisions, you know, that allow licences to be granted up to 2 years under the Wildlife and Countryside Act. but for fox control or other reasons that, you know, controlling, you know, hares or other sort of mammals for the other purposes set out under the Act, then, as I said earlier, we kind of think a 14-day licensing scheme is reasonable because those are more bespoke. You're not necessarily going to be doing those same things every, you know, at the same time of year, every single year, year and out. They very much depend upon the circumstances and whether you need a licence at that point, depending on what's happening. So they're not part of long-term programmes, and that's where we made that distinction.
So are you saying that controlling fox to protect ground nesting birds such as curlew and lapwing are not part of a long-term project such as stoat control?
Not in terms of the way the stoat eradication project works, and that this is a kind of a long-term established project which has been undertaken by Nature Scot in conjunction with partners. It's not to say that in the future, if some, you know, other scheme to protect a different species was set up, that it could not be considered under those licensing purposes. But at the moment, you know, I think, you know, this stoats ones are the ones, you know, that we're kind of thinking of in those kind of schemes. But
I mean, I would say that it's entirely possible that if someone was to come and say, as part of the Working for Waders project, for example, that they wanted to carry out systematic predator control to protect wading birds, that would be seen as a scheme by Nature Scot.
So this could, I suppose, Nature Scot could end up growing arms and legs, because this could be a really positive conduit to ensuring that we increase biodiversity levels. You know, the curlew numbers are, as you know, declining hugely. And so therefore, the government would consider then that this could be part of a long-term environmental project, particularly with the change in agricultural support, where farmers, you know, will be paid to be conservationists as such. Not that they are just now, but I feel that, you know, listening to what I've heard from Leah, that it's almost a discriminatory approach to animal welfare and biodiversity protection.
Well, I mean, we certainly recognise that predator control is an important part of wader conservation. And so if there is a project which is put to Nature Scot saying that this element is an important part of a project on a certain piece of land, I don't think there'll be any objection to that on principle, but it'll be about looking at the circumstances of that particular case. I mean, if I come back to the 14-day thing, I think that one of the key points around that is we envisage this being around sort of visits by a pack of dogs, by a foot pack or something like that. And so it's about that pack saying, well, you know, after discussion with the farmer, we intend to come and clear this piece of land, and we think we need a license for that. And it's about arranging that, and it's about giving a 14-day window for that, saying, you know, it may not be possible to do it on a given day because of weather conditions or something else. But, you know, so that is a different sort of proposition from someone saying, look, we're going to be out controlling stoats on this land, or we're going to be out removing hedgehogs from this land, or whatever, for the life of a project.
Okay. I think just another consideration. Yes, go on.
Before you move on, Jenny Minter's got a supplementary on that specific point.
Yes, thank you, convener. And it was just to expand that a wee bit more, because certainly the constituency that I represent, footpack is not done by footpacks, it's done by groups of farmers getting together. There have been concerns raised about only having a 14-day window might not work. And also, again, as Rachel Hamilton said, the difference between a larger organisation, so the RSPB being able, for example, is in the stoat example, being able to apply for a licence for 2 years, whereas farmers that are having to do that much more regularly to manage their livestock and the welfare of their livestock are having to do it more regularly without, they might argue, the resource that a larger organisation has. So it kind of goes back to my earlier point about it's remembering that we're not one Scotland's got lots of different parts to it, and recognising that there are different needs.
But I guess the sort of issue here is on that piece of land. I'm guessing that that would be sort of a, I must admit, I don't know enough about the sort of circumstance you're talking about, but I would envisage that farmers would be able to plan, well, we'll do farm A this in these couple of weeks, and we'll do farm B and whatever, and so on, and so that the licence would apply to, well, this is the licence period for doing farm A.
Yeah, so that, now, that's one side of it. Yeah. The other side of it is having the resource to be able to continually to apply for the licence as well, and how that would be worked.
Again, I mean, I would hope and expect that NatureScot, once they understand the circumstances which apply to a particular farm and the particular terrain and the particular problem it has with predation and the sort of livestock that they're managing, that a lot of that licence application could be done more quickly than having to start from fresh every time. So, you know, the sort of farm records about the losses they'd suffered and about the previous activities that have been undertaken, all of that would contribute to making a licensing process which is fairly, hopefully, fairly smooth and reasonably quick.
Okay. Rachel Hamilton, just to wind up in sections 4, 8 and 9, please.
Was there any consideration given to a general licence as opposed to, you know, what we're talking about requiring individual licences? So why can, like, pest bird species be managed under a general licensing regime, but not for foxes and mink, etc.?
So, yeah, we gave a lot of consideration to licensing, and as I said, I think we need to sort of bear in mind that this license is only about if you want to use more than two dogs. So you can still apply for a general license, or, you know, other kind of forms of licensing, or other forms of wildlife control that are permitted. So this license is about, I suppose, an exception to an exception. You know, it's an exception under the Act to use dogs to hunt, and if you want to use two, then more than two, that's a further exception to it. So we felt that individual licences were fair, because as we kind of set out in the Act that in order to get a licence, you have to demonstrate that there are no other reasonable methods that you could use. And, you know, that is dependent upon the circumstances. So it doesn't necessarily, you know, it will not necessarily follow that in one particular year, somebody would need a licence, and next year they might not. Now they might, you know, and if they have, you know, foxes that are sort of permanently kind of living in their territory, then they're probably going to, you know, apply regularly. There will be, you know, other cases where somebody might need to apply for a licence on a one-off basis. So it's kind of to recognise the fact that there will be a lot of different reasons, a lot of different circumstances that people are applying for a licence. But this is very much about making sure that the situation we've got at the moment, where, as Bonamy said, you know, you know, up to 20% of foxes are still being carried, you know, killed by packs of dogs, does not continue. That needs to be, in our view, regulated via a kind of a strict but fair licensing system.
So farmers will be able to apply for licences year-round, whether they're lambing or not, as to Jim Fairley's point earlier. So it's
there's got nothing preventative, to stop them.
And for every 14 days, do you think that NatureScot have the capacity to administrate this?
So we spoke to NatureScot, and yes, they are content that they have the resources to administer the scheme.
Okay.
Thank you. And a supplementary from Marianne Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. Continuing on the licensing scheme, so I'm keen to explore the transparency and the accountability of the licensing schemes. I appreciate your views on the proposal in Alison Johnson's Members' Bill from last session, Protecting Scotland's Wild Mammals, which stated that any use of a licence must be conditional on reporting how many animals have been killed or hunted, and that they've been killed in accordance with the licence. And this information should be published by the licensing authority.
So, as it's set out in the bill, then it does allow Nature Scot to put conditions on the licence, and that includes reporting conditions, and that's something that, as I said, we would seek to work with stakeholders on all sides to look at what are reasonable reporting requirements. So that could be something I would expect that something like the number of foxes killed and the locations and something would be something that would be in a licensing scheme. And as a committee will be aware, we also have the wider review of licensing. So the approach that we, bearing that in mind, the approach that we have taken in this bill is to set out the broad parameters, but we also don't want to be in a situation where we inadvertently put something within this bill that is then superseded by the outcome of the licensing review. So we're very much mindful of the fact that that review might impose further conditions, so we have the flexibility for that to be done, but we didn't want to set them out at that stage because that is kind of work that will be undertaken in the future.
When you had your discussions with Nature Scot about the 14 days granting and the capacity for that, did you discuss the accountability and transparency part?
Yeah, and I think what we've tried to sort of very much do is mindful of the fact that a lot of people who will be applying for these licences will also be applying for licences for various other things. We've had talk of ravens already today, for example. So again, to make it user friendly as much as possible, to kind of mirror what is kind of seen as the sort of the practices for those kind of licences, so that people broadly know what they're going to expect, but where it's kind of considered necessary and appropriate, there can be sort of bespoke elements added to that. So all of these kind of things have sort of been discussed initially, but they will continue to be discussed, and we know that stakeholders will give us lots of suggestions as well as to what they think should be included within a licensing scheme.
Could I just add, Ms. Burgess, that I think Nature Scot are very open to this. They are very keen on transparency in this area, subject to the sort of GDPR requirements and other sorts of data protection stuff, privacy. But I mean, in terms of giving information on how the licensing scheme operates, I mean, they've done it for a long time with reporting to the European Union, and they're still now looking at alternative processes to make that information into the public domain. And you'll see with things like the beaver licensing, where there's a lot of public interest, that they're very open about the number of animals that are taken under that scheme. And so I've absolutely no doubt that they would continue with this new licensing arrangement.
Thank you. And just a bit of clarity on the licensing for environmental benefit, which you may have touched on a bit. But so Section 8 states that a license in connection with Section 7 must not be granted unless the relevant authority is satisfied that killing, capturing or observing the wild mammal will contribute towards a significant or long-term environmental benefit. In order to help balance the need to protect certain species and enhance biodiversity against the need to protect the welfare of all sentient animals and manage wildlife ethically, will guidance be published on how to determine what meets the criteria for significant or long-term environmental benefit?
So we intend to publish guidance for the licensing regime, and to also do lots of publicity when it goes live. So all of that will be set out. And if you look at the other guidance that the Nature Scot produced, I think the kind of most recent new sort of licensing regime was for mountain hares, and that has a lot of guidance which kind of sets out what the parameters are and under what circumstances Nature Scot feel that there is evidence that a licence would be granted, and where they don't feel that there is evidence that the parameters of the scheme should be met. And same with the habitats regulations. There's lots of guidance out there as to what constitutes these tests that are being put into the licensing regime.
For licences to be granted, Nature Scot needs to be satisfied that there's, and I quote, no other solution that would be effective in achieving the purpose. So there might be alternatives that are effective but wholly impractical or undesirable. Does that mean that if an alternative practice is impractical, then it is by definition ineffective, or is effectiveness to be understood regardless of whether it's practical?
I think in order for it to be effective, you have to be able to do it. So if it was so impractical that you couldn't actually do it, then I think it would, as you said, not, you know, be deemed to be effective. So I'm kind of thinking, you know, the things we're thinking about, for example, if you had stoats predating on your chickens, then, you know, a reasonable, practical alternative might be to sort of, you know, build a sort of a decent enclosure. But, you know, it's not practical to, you know, necessarily put a fence around, you know, acres and acres of land, for example. Yeah. So it's those kind of things that would be taken into account. Again, that will vary depending on the person applying for the licence.
Thank you. That's useful. Jim Fairley.
Yeah, thanks very much. I'm just going to go back to something that Ariane's just raised there, because it's something that hadn't occurred to me at all. You're talking about recording numbers. Now, when I had a licence to control ravens, we knew that the purpose of the bag number that we were allowed every year that was increased was on the basis of we knew that numbers were limited. Beavers, we absolutely know more or less what the national numbers are. If you're going to record numbers of foxes are killed, are we concerned that foxes are becoming a rare species in Scotland? Yeah. So what would be the purpose of recording numbers?
Well, I think it's just to understand how many licences are being issued and what they are being used for.
Not the number of foxes that would be controlled?
Well, I mean, I think that would be... I mean, I'm not prejudging what conditions people are going to ask for, but, I mean, I think there will be some public interest in how this licensing scheme is operating, in the number of licences that are being granted and in the number of foxes that are being killed under it. And I don't... It doesn't necessarily reflect that we think that foxes are an endangered species, because we don't. But it's just to have transparency around the way the licensing scheme is operating. And I think if people were to say to us, well, that's harming people operating the licensing in some way, we'd listen to those arguments. But on the basis that I don't see any particular reason why we'd want to withhold that information, and I'm pretty sure there'll be public interest in it, we will probably look to provide it.
Okay. The other thing that was mentioned was the issuing of a licence for environmental issues, and it would have to be done under a scheme. Now, again, I'm giving my own personal experience here. I watched wading bird numbers absolutely plummet with the increased number of ravens, but nobody was listening to that. Now, the byproduct of me being able to control ravens to protect sheep was that it kind of helped the wading bird numbers. So who's the best person to tell Nature Scot that there is an environmental issue or an ecological issue on land that they are managing? Who makes that decision?
So ultimately that will be for, if somebody's applying for a licence, ultimately be for Nature Scot to make that decision. I think we're all, you know, well aware of the sort of issues. So I'm sure you know Nature Scot has recently launched an action plan to address the decline in capercaillie. So it's those kind of things. And I know that there are a lot of land managers who are, you know, actively on board and you know, working with Nature Scot to kind of, you know, put those action points into place to protect capercaillie. And one of the sort of strands of that action plan is effective predator control in areas where capercaillie are. So it's those kind of things, again, we're sort of, you know, envisaging would, you know, constitute a scheme, as opposed to me just going out and saying I've decided I want to, you know, clear all the wild mammals off my you know, backyard because I want to protect my marigolds. You know, that wouldn't be a scheme, but things like, you know, the capercaillie project or similar projects I think would meet the, you know, the criteria for a scheme.
So there's going to have to be this cooperation and this trust between Nature Scot and land managers, isn't there?
I think you're just going to have to sort of, you know, demonstrate that you meet the criteria that's set out within the bill. So it'll be up to you if you're saying I need to, you know, control predators on my land and I need a licence and I'm doing it for protection of agriculture. You'll need to kind of show, you know, how that, what that link is and what that evidence is. If you say I'm doing it for a different purpose, again, you will need to provide evidence that's going to satisfy Nature Scot. What evidence you need to do will very much, you know, depend. There are some very clear established, you know, nature conservation issues that we're aware of, such as with curlews and lapwings. If you said I'm doing it to protect, you know, something else, Nature Scot might go, well, actually, we don't necessarily have evidence that this species is in decline, and, you know, they might ask to see more information as to why you think it's necessary.
Okay, thank you.
Very briefly, Rachel Hamilton.
Yeah, I'm just trying to work this out, because with a general licence, you still have to prove that you have looked at all other solutions of dispatch or prejudice control, whatever you want to call it. What are the solutions to control fox? And obviously there's a high number across Scotland that farmers could use other than, you know, a gun.
I think, again, that would depend. Like I said, if you are keeping enclosed birds, then it
might... But what about sheep? Yeah. I mean, how would you enclose sheep?
Well, I think that goes back to the point Mr. Carn said, that yeah, enclosing sheep might not be a practical solution. So you would have to look at other things. So you might kind of say, well, we've had people out lamping. That's not worked. The terrain is such that, you know, we need to use a pack to flush foxes, because two foxes would just not be effective. You might say we've deployed a shepherd. That hasn't worked. So it very much depends. Obviously, farms range massively in sizes of terrain. And so that's why we're not doing a list of here's all of the things you have to have tried first. It's up to you to kind of go, okay, these are things that are potentially reasonable that I could have tried in the area that I am, you know, applying for a licence for, and they haven't been effective.
So a farmer would have to come to Nature Scot and say, I'm sorry, but my farm income is only £12,000 a year. Things are really tough. I don't want to employ a shepherd. I'm using Easy Care sheep on an upland farm. I'd like to control my foxes. I've got a declining population of wading birds. How easy is this going to be? Because the AICS scheme is very complicated to apply for.
Well, as I said, I think that is, it's those kind of things that we will work to, as we, as our Nature Scot will do, work with stakeholders as they develop the licensing scheme. But you know, if you're applying for a license, for example, to you know, lethally control beavers, you have to, you know, show that you have tried all other sort of methods that don't require a license and that are open to you. So again, that test already exists in other wildlife legislation. So we're
But to be clear here, though, it isn't the statutory requirement will be for the licensing authority to be satisfied. So that implies that they may have knowledge of their own about what is practical.
But Nature Scot and their website don't even suggest how to control fox.
No, well, I mean, the point here, though, as I'm saying, is it's not a requirement on the farmer or the land manager or landowner to say, I've tried A, B, C and D. I mean, they can say as part of their application, they might be invited to say, but it's for Nature Scot to say, well, OK, we accept that, you know, you don't need to demonstrate that it's not possible to put a cage fence around your land. I mean, I think they just got to understand that already. So, I mean, I think it's about what is practicable and widely understood to be practicable in particular circumstances. And I think that Nature Scot understand full well that in managing and protecting livestock such as lambs on an upland situation, you're going to have a number of options. You might have snaring, you might have lamping, you might have using night sights, you might have using dogs. These are likely to be your main options. Live trapping may be another option. So they will understand those, what are the things which are on the table. And they may well understand that for a small crofter, the idea of employing a full-time shepherd on the hill is just out of the question. So I don't think it's having to go through each and every single potential scenario. This is something which already operates across the whole gamut of licensing, mm-hmm. that no satisfactory alternative. But in all of that, it never says that it's for the licensed applicant to prove. It's always for the licensing authority to be satisfied.
Mm. And the same applies to a fox travelling across upland that was 3,000 acres, where one farmer had applied for a licence and it travelled to the next farm. And therefore, how does that work if that farmer then dispatched that fox over the march?
Yeah, I mean, the licensing is only where there's the use of more than two dogs.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I think we're all pretty much aware that the vast majority of foxes are dispatched through shooting of one form or another. And I think that will continue to be the case, but I'm not, mm-hmm.
Unless,
sure,
of course,
I follow the issue.
And you are, the government are advocating lamping, which is only really, in terms of welfare, relevant in three seasons where there is a proper site and it out with vegetation and cover. Yeah. And there's a lot of vegetation and cover up in upland. So,
I mean, I'd like to be clear. I mean, we're not advocating lamping. What we're doing is we're trying to prevent the use of dogs to chase and kill wild mammals. That's what this bill is about. And we are recognising in the course of that that there are alternatives to that in terms of protecting livestock. And those alternatives include the sort of range of things I've just said, and the most common of which, as we know, is probably shooting.
Thank you. We'll need to move on. We're now going to cover section 11 and 12. Question from Alistair Allen and then Beatrice Wishart.
I was actually thinking of trail hunting as an issue I was interested in. You want me to
Later on? Or? Question 14 in section 11 and 12. Yep.
Yeah, I was interested just to know why trail hunting, what the reasoning was for including trail hunting within the scope of the bill.
So trail hunting, which is where a person or a group of people will lay an animal-based scent for dogs to follow. So that activity really only sort of came into existence after the Hunting Act was introduced in England and Wales. And there were suspicions at the time that that activity was being introduced as a cover for people who were not happy that traditional forms of fox hunting had been banned, and were using that as a way to circumvent the law. I think that has kind of shown to be the case in some circumstances. There was a case last year where somebody was prosecuted, and there was clear evidence that that's exactly what they were doing, and subsequently it has been banned in land owned by the Welsh Government, National Trust land, because of that. But even where people are not setting out in any way to, you know, carry out illegal hunting, when they're kind of, you know, doing it as an alternative because they recognise that they're not permitted to chase and kill wild mammals with dogs, that it carries a very sort of high risk that an animal will be inadvertently killed. So, you know, dogs are very clever animals, but if they are following a trail that's been artificially laid, that smells of a fox, they're in an area where foxes are present, then there is a high risk that they will end up chasing a real life fox instead. And as we know, when that happens, there is a real risk. So what we are seeking to do is to prevent that happening in Scotland. So it is only where people are laying a trail that is designed to replicate a wild mammal. So drag hunting, for example, uses an artificial scent aniseed, so that will still be permitted, and people can still carry out that activity. They can kind of still go out with their you know, dogs and their horses and follow on. But what we are seeking to do is take away the element of risk that is laying that mammal-based scent, which is, you know, providing a loophole for people doing illegal hunting and also causing serious welfare concerns. And that's the reason for the provisions within this bill.
Thank you. Just finally on that, I suppose, is there an analogy there between, a kind of analogy between that and what you were saying earlier on about hares and rabbits, where one thing can either be done under the cover of another or can turn into something else? Was there public concerns about that type of situation expressed through the consultation?
Yes, there was a lot of concern raised by stakeholders. I said, I think people had paid very close attention to what had happened in England and Wales to the court cases, and also kind of, you know, looked at, you know, the concerns that were raised by National Trust members, which, you know, led them to banning it on their land. So it's now, you know, banned in National Trust land in Scotland, for example. So yes, very much listening to what people were saying about that.
Thank you.
Swishart. Okay, well,
thanks, convener. I was just waiting for the video and audio to come on again. Section 12, there's an exception for training dogs to follow a scent. The section applies if a person lays an animal-based scent for a dog to find and follow in order to train a dog for a lawful purpose. I just wonder if you could explain or clarify what lawful purpose actually means.
Yeah, so that provision is in there because we were very much Dale, mindful of the fact that if we didn't allow dogs to be trained, you would inadvertently, you know, end up, you know, banning certain activities such as deer stalking or predator control that use scent-based hounds by the back door, because if you can't train dogs to do those activities, then those activities can't take place. So where we've set out in the bill where it's lawful to use a dog to search for a stalk of flush, a wild mammal, then you would be allowed to, you know, lay a trail to train a dog to do those activities. If you think probably the most obvious example of where it's very much not lawful to use a dog to undertake, you know, actions as, you know, badger baiting. So if somebody was, you know, deliberately deemed to be training a dog to find and kill badgers, that's not a lawful activity. So, you know, that is the distinction that we're trying to make. So what is permitted under the bill where you're allowed to use dogs, you're allowed to train those dogs to do those activities.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ed. Jim Fairley.
Sorry, guys, I'm going back a bit. I forgot to ask you something earlier on. It was something I picked up in the bill as I was reading through it. It's on page 19, and it is Crown Application Criminal Offences. So it's 24.1. Nothing in this Act makes the Crown criminally liable. What does that mean?
I'll maybe start off on that, but I might ask SGLD colleagues to come in if I mangle that. So there is a distinction between the Crown, as in, you know, the likes of me and you know, an official and MSPs, and the Crown as in the Queen herself. So it's that distinction. So, you know, people who are operating in the service of the Crown can be criminally liable, but, you know, the Queen is kind of treated, you know, differently for legal purposes. So that's basically what I've sent out to. That's kind of, you know, standard pretty much, I think, in most, you know, bills that to do with criminal justice. It kind of sets out how it applies to the Crown and to members of the Crown, but also how it applies to the Queen herself.
So what that means is if an illegal act took place on the Queen's land, it would be the person who was perpetrating the act as opposed to the Queen who was liable. Is that what that means?
So, yeah, it means that somebody who is, you know, committing a crime on the Queen's land, you know, can still be considered like anybody else. So it means they're not exempted and they're treated in the same way as anybody would be who committed a crime on, you know, non-Crown land.
OK, thank you.
And finally, on enforcement, the offence in the bill is hunting using a dog. So dogs are absolutely essential ingredient right through the bill. So surely what mode of transport is used to accompany the dogs should be irrelevant. Yet the bill suggests that there could be disqualification orders for dogs and they can seize horses. why are those on horseback being singled out in the bill as drafted and not, for example, quad bike owners?
So the bill in the schedule attached to the bill, it talks about the seizure of vehicles and gives police the power to seize vehicles. And if they seize vehicles, then there is other legislation. It's the Proceeds of Crime Act that would allow a quad bike that had been used in the commission of a hunting offence to be seized. So horses, we're not singling out, you know, people who use horses. We're just kind of looking at the range of things that somebody might use in the commission of offence, whether that's dogs, horses or quad bikes, and making sure that all of those things are covered. And it just allows the court as wide a range of powers as possible to consider what the most appropriate offence is.
Very briefly,
yeah,
Rachel, please.
Sorry. Leah, on that, that specific point, where does it say, for example, that a deprivation order could be given against, say, a hair courser who had used a car to drive from somewhere else like Newcastle and a motorbike and whatever else they used? Is that covered in this? Just to be clear. Yeah, I'm looking right at it. It's page 16.
So, the schedule attached talks about the seizure of vehicles.
Yeah.
And what that, and if a vehicle is seized, then, and it is kind of, you know, deemed to be used in the commission of offence, then separately under the Proceeds of Crime Act, then the courts have the power to forfeit those vehicles or other equipment as set out in the Act that have been seized as evidence and deemed to have been used in a crime.
Okay. Thank you.
That, you'll be pleased to hear, brings us to our end of our question. Well, it probably doesn't, but I think you've put in a hard shift this morning, particularly you, Leah. Thank you very much. It is very much appreciated. The information you've given us will certainly help us in our further deliberations. We'll now suspend this meeting until 12 o'clock to allow a change of witnesses. Thank you. We now move on to agenda item two, which is consideration of the Official Controls Extension of Transitional Periods Amendment Regulations 2022, and I refer members to papers 3 and 4. Do any members have any questions or comments to make on the instruments? No. Do members agree with the Scottish Government's dissent to consent to the provision set out in the notification being included in UK rather than Scottish subordinate legislation? Agreed. I also propose the committee writes to the Scottish Government to ask why it now considered appropriate to make regulations amending the rules around checks on SPS goods during the transition period, and what the impact of these changes may be on stakeholders and the wider public, including further information about the outcomes of the consultations between governments and stakeholders and the outcomes of discussions with stakeholders who have invested in preparation for the end of the transitional staging period. Are members happy with those suggestions? Thank you. That concludes our business in public. We now close our business on Blue Jeans and meet in private session.